So now we are going to study belt drives. Now that's going to be important, and what we'll do, we'll systematically look at all the free body diagrams. Okay. Now we'll study this based on first, concept. So we'll take up a problem and try to see the concept. Can we draw the individual free body diagram and try to decide that where the impending slip will happen? See, problem is like this. We have a motor. Let's say B has a motor. So that means it's a, I will say this is a driver drum. This is my driver pulley. Okay? And this is the driven pulley. So ultimately, motor, you are applying some torque, right? That torque is being transmitted to this pulley, and in this pulley, some machine tool is connected which is rotating. So ultimately, motor is helping that machine tool to rotate on the same direction. Don't forget. Now, what I will do, I am saying the velocity is constant. So it's a constant speed problem. So that means belt and the pulley both are rotating at same speed. But there is no slippage between the belt. That means there is no actual slippage between the belt and the pulley. They have same angular velocities. Okay. Now, what happens if you really try to draw the free body diagram very carefully? So, this is the free body diagram of the driver pulley. How do I decide on which side will be tension side? If the drum is rotating clockwise, okay. So here I am applying a torque, this is my motor. Now that torque is simply balanced against the frictional resistance. You see that? This is the frictional resistance direction. That frictional resistance, as per the Newton's third law, will be transferred to the belt. If you detach the belt, try to draw the free body diagram. So that's the direction of the friction on that belt. Therefore, which side should have a greater tension? It is this side. So this side should have a greater tension. That means in this belt, this side should have a greater tension. Now, if you don't want to detach the belt from the body, then it is also clear that T2 minus T1 multiplied by the R should be equals to the moment applied. So there is a clockwise torque. To balance that, I need an anti-clockwise torque. So therefore, this side tension has to be greater than this side tension. Is that clear now? What happens to this? Ultimately, torque is being transmitted here. How? Remember, I have this tension now is greater than this tension. So therefore, I could say T2 minus T1 R. So actually, drum will be rotating like this, clockwise fashion. No question about that. But how do I draw the free body diagram? Which is rotating the drum, by the way? Which is rotating the drum? It is basically the frictional force that is acting. And look at the direction of the friction. This is helping the drum to rotate. Now, what is the M1 then? M1 is, remember, I have considered the free body diagram of the driven drum. So, for the driven pulley, there is a machine tool attached. So that machine tool will give a force back, a torque back, as per the Newton's third law, onto the drum. So that is shown here. So ultimately, you are definitely transmitting a torque T2 minus T1 R, which is clockwise. But to show the equilibrium, right, I have a machine tool that is giving back the torque to the drum, which is M1. Clear? But when you look at the machine tool which is connected here, that will have a clockwise torque at the immediate end. Okay? So from this free body, you can clearly see ultimately this drum, the driven pulley, is rotated by the frictional resistance. Okay, and the transmitted torque is nothing more than T2 minus T1 multiplied by R. Now, here is the question. What is the maximum power that I can transmit? What is the maximum torque that I can transmit? So, the maximum torque will be determined by the condition of impending slip. Impending slip means the belt is just trying to slip over one of the drum. Okay, such that the maximum friction force has been attained. Maximum friction force is already being achieved, and that's the capability that you have to transmit the torque. Now, question is, where should I have the impending slip of the belt with respect to these two drums or these two pulleys? So, impending slip, as I said, it will be completely controlled by two parameters. One is the mu s, that is the static coefficient of friction, and the beta. For in this problem, remember, it is a constant velocity problem, so we are going to use the static coefficient of friction. Okay. So, mu s and beta, now if both have same mu s, then ultimately wherever I have beta small, that means contact angle small, their impending slip prevail. The impending slip will first happen over there. So, with that, now you can quickly solve a problem. Just look at this problem. So, a flat belt connects pulley A, okay, which drives a machine tool. So, now this is again the machine tool I have. There is a machine tool connected here. This is the motor that is my driver. This is a driver drum. This is a driven drum. Okay, as we said, now here we are really interested in finding out, determine the largest torque which can be exerted by the belt on pulley A. Okay, so what is the largest torque that can be transmitted? So, as I said, it's very simple. First, we find out that where the impending slip will happen. So, we have to decide on the fact that which will undergo the impending slip first. Remember, we already know which side has the higher tension. So, it is given already maximum allowable tension in the belt is 600 Newton. So, if the allowable tension is given maximum, then which side that will happen? It has to be on the top side. So, this belt here you will have the higher tension. And we have already shown that based on the logic, because this is a driven drum. Right? So, here I have the maximum tension. And then we decide on the contact angle. Since mu s remains same, then from the contact angle, I can determine which one will undergo impending slip. Right? So, therefore, now if I find out the impending slip where it happens first, in this case, you will be able to show that B will slip first because there you have a less contact angle. Then we have to, then we can impose the friction law condition, that is T2 by T1 equals to eta mu s B, right? And find out the other torque in the belt. And once that is found, then we can say that what is the torque transmitted to the pulley A. Is that clear? Okay. Now, you can further show that there will be no slip in this case. If the impending slip is at B, then there is no slip at pulley A by saying that T2 by T1 is less than e to the power mu s beta. Or the mu s, if you calculate based on the relationship of T2 and T1, if you calculate the mu s, that should be less than the mu s max. Mu s max is actually what is the static coefficient of friction. Clear? So, now we can easily look into this problem, and we don't want to get into more detail. As I said, first main target will be to find out the contact angle. Look at the contact angles carefully. So, here I have total contact angle equals to 240 degree. here it has to be 30 plus 90, that is 120 degree. Okay, so in radians we measure the contact angles, and as I said, where the impending slip will happen, wherever I have low contact angle. So it's like a friction force also, mu s n. Remember, F max equals to mu s n, that was in the simple friction. Wherever you had a value of less n, right, their friction, you know, their impending slip was happening. So it is always controlled by mu s and n. In this case, it is controlled by mu s and beta. Now you have two parameters. Okay, so beta was less here, impending slip happens here. So therefore, I have one unknown in this problem, which is T1. And I know this is going to be the higher tension side. So T2 by T1 equals to e to the power mu s beta, and I can solve for T1. Okay, so now what we have to do, we can check that impending slip is actually not happening here. So how do I check it? I already know the value of tensions on the both sides. So we can check that. The check would be, we simply calculate the mu s, that mu s should be less than 0.25. Okay, the torque transmitted can be found. The torque transmitted is really T2 minus T1 multiplied by R, but that's a very simple operation. T2 minus T1 multiplied by R is what the torque is being transmitted. Remember, this MA, this is given by the machine tool to the drum. I again repeat, this MA is something that is given by the machine tool that is connected here to the drum. Okay. And this part is simply a verification that impending slip is not happening at A. This is one way of doing it. Other way is, if you just do T2 by T1, that has to be less than e to the power mu s, the mu s that is given mu x beta, beta of this pulley. Clear? So can we have a quick discussion on this problem specially? Any question on this problem? Okay, just to clarification, there is a question, why the rotation of the driven pulley is in the opposite direction. That is not true at all. What is shown is the free body diagram there. Driven pulley will be on the same direction as that of the driver pulley. So what is given is just the torque. If we go back to the slide, this is just the torque. Okay, this is a driven pulley. Torque is actually being applied. If you can see it, this torque, negative this torque multiplied by R, that will of course rotate the drum in this direction. It's a constant velocity problem, don't forget. We have always assumed that it's a, you know, constant velocity is achieved. So as per Newton's first law, the torque transmitted is T2 minus T1 R. Now this is shown as per the free body diagram, because this torque is given by the machine tool to the drum. So the machine tool that is connected will see the torque in the same direction. Direction means clockwise direction. Machine tool will see the torque on the clockwise direction, but drum will see the torque on counterclockwise direction. But pulley is rotating clockwise, don't forget, because you have T2 minus T1 multiplied by R. Okay. Any question? Just go visit.
Yeah. If you are running like a camshaft.
Yeah, so it's a camshaft. So let's say you have a camshaft, then what happens? Okay. So the question is, it becomes complex. See, friction itself is a complex aspect. And if you try to now in the very first class tell students that what happens in a camshaft, I think it's not going anywhere. We have to be very, you know, kind of specialized on telling them how to draw the free body diagram. Let us not try to get into complex problems. In fact, you know, camshaft itself is in a research oriented field. Can we draw the free body diagram? Have we understood the free body diagram? Have you understand the constant motion problem? That is what we need to tell the students. As a teacher is fine, we can always gain our knowledge, you know, through different research aspect. But my request to all of you would be, keep the topic to as simple as it can, and try to analyze the free body diagrams. Okay?
The slide number 25, what about the rotation?
Can you see the slide now? Rotation is happening on the same direction. Again, what I have drawn, this is the free body of the forces, nothing to do with the kinematics of the problem. There is a difference between kinetics and kinematics. Kinetics deals with the force. So what I have shown here, it's all the forces. Forces is a general term that also include the moment. So now tell me what is missing here, what we don't understand. To rotate this drum, to rotate the motor, I need a torque that is being applied. Okay? Everything is rotating clockwise. That's the kinematics of it. Fine. Now I am trying to understand, is that the torque has to be applied. Applied torque is this. What balances the torque if you really take this drum out? Give it a thought. It is balanced by the frictional resistance that is coming into play. It's a constant velocity problem. So therefore, something has to balance that torque. That torque from the body is going to the pulley. It is going to the belt. So on the belt, you see the direction is reversed. That's Newton's third law. Now you can clearly see if my frictional direction is this way. So free body of the belt, if I do, then this side has to have the larger tension, because the resistance is in this way, clockwise. So this is my T2 greater than T1. Is that clear now? Similarly, in this one, this torque is a consequence of the machine tool giving back to the drum. If you are detaching, isolating the drum, this is the torque coming from the machine tool to the drum. Because everything has to be in equilibrium, it's an equilibrium problem, constant velocity, Newton's first law. Okay? So therefore, this is the torque, but it does not mean it is rotating the drum in, you know, in this direction. It is just the torque that is coming into play. This torque is balanced by T2 minus T1 multiplied by R. Okay, because this is a higher torque. So this is going to give it a clockwise torque. So what the purpose of saying that, this is very helpful to understand why this thing is rotating. What is making it to rotate? It is simply rotated by the frictional resistance. You see that? This friction force will always rotate the drum clockwise. It can't rotate counterclockwise. Okay? Clear?
What is the minimum slip angle between a belt and pulley?
Minimum contact angle. That will be determined by what? You tell me, na? So your question is that what is the minimum contact angle? You tell me. Give the answer.
Tension.
Yeah, it is determined by tension, right? Okay. So it depends. The question should be posed based on the problem framework. See, if your question is, okay, what is the, I want to drive this much of maximum torque. Let's say your question is like that. I want to drive this much of maximum torque. What is the contact angle necessary? That makes more relevant. Okay? Minimum contact angle that is desired. Okay? Thank you.
Can you please go to problem?
If pulley D is fixable, what's the reaction force on the pulley D?
Yeah, that's a, you know, so your question is, how do you draw the free body diagram of this pulley? See, here, first of all, you have a T2 and T1, right? So based on that, remember, this is a fixed, this is not a hinge, right? So do you want me to draw the free body diagram quickly? I'll draw it for you, okay? I am now drawing the free body diagram, okay? Both the pulley and the belt, okay? So in this problem, now let's say, first of all, understand, we said the kinematics of the problem is that it is slipping in this direction, right? Okay? So this is the slip. Let's draw step by step, everything will be clear. What I'll do, I'll try to detach the belt first. So I have detached the belt. clear? If I detach the belt, what kind of friction force it is going to see? Since the slip direction is this way, the friction force is going to be, is that clear? If this is my friction force direction, then which direction the tension will be higher? Is that clear now? Okay. Now consider the drum. Drum is fixed. So fixed means it can take a reaction as a torque. Don't forget that. If I have to fix it, that means it can take a reaction as a torque. Okay. So now you transfer this frictional resistance in here. So that means this is the, you know, complete, you know, detached free body diagram. So here you have this contact angle, right? That contact angle was there. So this area we have the friction force, right? Then you have the reactions, and how the moment should come into play? Moment should come into play like this way. This is the moment reaction. Now if you combine these two together, if I really combine these two, then all you see is, you don't see the interface friction force. Friction force at the interface. So your free body diagram becomes okay. Now you tell me what is the problem to solve for these three reactions if I know T2 and T1. Is there any problem? I take sum of force along x0, sum of force along y0, and moment about O, right, sum of forces equals to 0. So remember, this M0 will therefore be simply equals to T2 minus T1 multiplied by R. So remember, the entire thing here is, it's a fixed drum. If it is not fixed, that means you make a pin here, it's going to rotate. Okay, then you have acceleration or deceleration depending on what you are doing on the system. So again, see, you know, dynamic problem, it's a constant motion problem, those things can be analyzed based on the fact, or very slow motion can be analyzed based on static problem. Whatever static problem we have done, based on those concepts, it can always be solved. Is that clear? Just one more problem of that of a break, okay? Band break we have discussed. So let's say I have a band break now. Again, remember, we are posing the problem in a such a way I can solve it based on equilibrium. And I have thoroughly told you that each and every free body diagram can be drawn. Free body diagram can be drawn and equilibrium can be taken. No question about that, okay? Now in this problem, I have a differential band break. What it does? It is rotating at a constant speed. So there is, let's say, some axle is there and it is just rotating like this. Does not matter. Okay, it is pin about this point, it is rotate. What we are doing essentially, that this band, okay, this belt, is allowing it to maintain a constant speed. Again, how it is maintaining a constant speed? Because remember, for a given value of force, I have some tension induced here. Therefore, I have friction force. That friction force will be, you know, fixed for a given value of P. In other words, for a given value of P, I am going to get some given tension here. And therefore, the torque can be controlled. So to maintain a constant speed, I need basically, let's say, TA minus TB equals TA minus TB multiplied by R. The problem is clear. Now what is being asked? Determine the magnitude of the force P that is exerted on end A of the lever arm when the drum is rotating clockwise and the drum is rotating counterclockwise. Remember, it is rotating at a constant speed, and for that we are transferring a couple of magnitude 125 pound foot. That means a torque is already being said to be there, and this torque is going to keep the speed constant. So the only question is, if the torque is clockwise, if the torque is counterclockwise, then what is the value of the force? Remember, this band will be constantly slipping over this drum. That means there is always a relative slip between the band and the drum. Okay. So as I said, there is a relative slip between belt and drum. What we have to do, moment equilibrium of drum about center of drum will give the tension generated in both sides of the drum. Again, moment equilibrium of lever, that means this is the lever ABC, ABD, about point B will give the force P. How many unknowns do I have in this problem? See, I have actually, if you look at it carefully, very, very carefully, this is my unknown P, tension in B, tension in A, three unknowns, plus there are two reactions. If I just look at this, right? Now, how many equations, now for this lever, how many equilibrium equations I have? Three. That means I have two extra unknowns. Those two extra unknowns, how I am going to solve? Basically, I have to invoke the friction law. That means there has to be a relationship between TA and TB. As well as, remember, we are also given with a condition here that the magnitude of the couple is given. That means TB minus T1 multiplied by R is also given. Okay. So to look at the problem in this way, we can clearly draw all the free body diagrams. So first problem was, it is rotating clockwise. That means a clockwise torque is also given. You see that clockwise torque? If a clockwise torque is given that way, then which side of the tension should be greater? TA. TA should be greater than TC. Has to happen to balance that torque. Okay? Now, therefore, from the first part, I just solve, the moment is given, that torque, applied torque is given. So I write down that TA minus TC, okay, multiplied by R, that must be equals to the torque. Remember, it is just converted by this 12. Don't look at the numbers here. TA minus TC multiplied by R equals to 125, and it is converted in inch. So this is pound inch. So I get a relationship of TA and TC. What is my second condition? For slip in belt, actual slip, relative slip, I have TA by TC, that should be equals to e to the power mu k multiplied by the contact angle. Okay. So TA and TC can be solved. Clear? So similarly, you can now think of, once I know the TA and TC, I can now take the equilibrium of this arm, lever arm. So this lever equilibrium suggests that I should be able to solve for the force P. Since TA and TC is already known, I take the moment about point B to solve. Okay. So ultimately, we are going to get the answer, that is the P required equals to this. That means to maintain that constant speed at that value of torque and the drum is rotating clockwise, I have to apply a force P equals to 146 pound. Now the problem can just be reversed. Reversed means now it is rotating counterclockwise. So if it rotates counterclockwise in the anticlockwise direction, then what happens? Then I have TC greater than TA, that's the only thing. So I will just reverse the problem. TC and TA is reversed. This will be exactly same. So you are going to get an answer of 9.41. So that means to rotate it clockwise, I need larger force than to rotate it counterclockwise. Now I leave it to for you in homework then why to rotate in clockwise, I need a larger force than that of this. When I am rotating counterclockwise, why do I need a smaller force? So let's take that as a homework and we can discuss later on. Okay? So 2 minute discussion, 2-3 minutes. Anyone has any question regarding this? Everything, as I'm saying, that as long as static is concerned, we can also include in static constant velocity, constant motion problem, no issue. And we can simply try to draw the free body diagrams to get the desired forces. Remember, every time I'm solving a statically determinate problem, in engineering mechanics, I can't deliver a knowledge on statically indeterminate. I need to go to the advanced level of studies where the statically indeterminate problem is solved based on the concept of kinematics. That means actual deformation of the body. Yes, 1088.
Sir, in problem number 2, why the weight of block A is greater than tension T2?
Your question is, in this problem, why the tension in this side is greater than this side? Look at the problem statement. Which direction is rotating?
Yes, sir.
It is rotating clockwise. That means you are actually applying a torque,
yeah.
Right? So if I apply a clockwise torque to balance that, what needs to be what do I have to do? I need a counterclockwise torque. How do I generate a counterclockwise torque? Wa minus this multiplied by R, isn't that clear? Therefore, Wa has to be greater than this.
Yes.
Okay, clear now? Good question, okay.
Sir, why the weight of belt is not considered in the derivation of belt friction?
What will happen if I even consider that? We are not physicists, we are engineering. We don't care about 10% error in our solution. Is that answer to your question? Usually tension will be much higher than if I have to include that effect of load. Okay. 1224.
Sir, I have the answer for a second problem you asked, that because the weight of the AB should be lifted up, that's why for rotating clockwise it's more difficult than rotating anticlockwise.
Fine, yeah, okay.
1037.
How the friction between belt and pulley can be reduced? If we use oil or grease, then belt will start slipping. How to reduce friction between belt and pulley?
Your question is how to reduce the friction between belt and pulley. Why do I want to do that? I want to transmit the maximum torque possible. Then why should I try to reduce it? I should try to maximize it, right?
In case of fluid friction, sir, when to take dynamic viscosity and when to take kinematic?
We are not talking about fluid mechanics here, okay? So we are limiting ourselves to only static coefficient of friction and kinematic coefficient of friction. 1043, can you hear me? Yeah, just go ahead, please.
Yes, sir. You already explained in the problem number 2 that WA, the weight, WA is more than tension in the rope. But still we are not getting it.
See, what we are trying to look at the problem statement. What is being said in the problem number 2, right? I am applying the, you know, pulley is rotated very slowly clockwise. See, I am trying to raise the load. Remember, I have one load here on that pulley and then there are other connections. Through that, there is another load 16 pound, right? So I am slowly rotating it to raise the load. So rotating direction, remember, is clockwise. Now how do you rotate a body, first of all? I have to apply a torque, that is not given. But I know that applied torque has to be balanced by the tension produced. So now you think of it, I am applying a clockwise torque which is not given in the problem. That is not necessary. Now, therefore, to balance that clockwise torque, I need a counterclockwise torque. So now how the counterclockwise torque will come into play? Wa multiplied by R, negative tension on the other side multiplied by R, because therefore Wa has to be greater than the tension on the other side. Okay, clear? You can also look at the way I have shown the friction, right? Again, if you think, if you detach the belt, if you detach the belt, then what is actually causing that rotation? What is helping this rotation? Friction, right? The friction is causing that rotation to happen, isn't that? So from that also you can get this. But simple way to look at is that you are rotating it clockwise, but I need a counterclockwise torque to balance it. Clear?
Okay, okay, sir. So I have another question, sir. If what happen if rope is wound spirally on the capstan?
Rope is?
What will be the effect on wound spirally, sir?
Spiral.
Not horizontally, in the circular form, spirally.
So fine, no, that it is the. So your question is if the rope is spiral. In the sense what? That means you are trying to tie it many times, like the bollard problem.
Wounding spirally, sir, many times.
Yeah, so that is a wrap, right? How many wrap you have in a, let's say, bollard or a
wrapping spirally?
Yes, yes. So in that way, it's all depends on the contact angle, nothing else. We just have to figure out what is the contact angle, and we have solved that problem in a simple way, right? That bollard problem. You remember when you go to the jetty, na? When you go to a fish jetty, you see the boats are coming, and someone suddenly jumps from the boat and try to put the rope around the that bollard, or you know, so that's a wrapping problem.
Practically, they are wrapping like that only. But what we studied in they must be wrapped closely.
Okay,
Capstan.
Yeah, so that will make it more complex.
That equation is valid.
Yes, yes, that will make it more complex. Nothing else. I mean, okay. Yeah, I think we can now take a break.